So if you got your Bibles, turn with me to Joshua. Joshua chapter 1. All right, Joshua chapter 1. All right, Joshua chapter 1. Because, you know, we're dealing with distractions today, aren't we? It's interesting. I'm sorry.
Keep me awake.
I keep you awake. I love the fact that when the last time it went off, the first thing that Richard does is said, "Come on, Pastor." And I'm going, "Really, you got to identify where the real challenge is today, amen?" There's always going to be distractions, amen? Do you believe that? There's always going to be distractions right now. But I mean, there's going to be distractions that try to get you off of what God's really trying to say and what God's trying to do today. I truly believe that. But God does have a plan today, and I'm so excited that He has a plan, amen? And God is going to work in amazing ways today. So in Joshua chapter 1, that's where we're going to be at today. And we're going to talk about, we've been in a series called Renovation. And we spent 3 weeks dealing with personal renewal. We talked about spiritual renewal to the Holy Spirit, about surrendering our lives to Christ. We talked about this word abiding, specifically about how important it is that He is the branch, we are vine, He is the vine, we are the branches. And we are going to abide, amen? And so we've talked about that. Last week we talked about the church in Matthew, and the foundation of the church is Jesus, amen? And what are we? As part of that foundation, we are not the foundation, amen? Who is the foundation? The foundation is Jesus. We are little stones, and how are we going to build the church one stone at a time? One stone at a time. And that requires all of us in the church to say, I've got to be active. I've got to be active in this kingdom building. I've got to be active in this whole idea of discipleship. It's part of the plan. And so when you look around, part of the plan is you. There's no plan B. Like the church is plan A, and there's no plan B. There's no B. Anybody got a plan B? Hello? I mean, do you have a plan A? That's a question. Some people don't even have a plan A. We're going to look at that, right? I don't know. Should I try this again? See if this turns on? No. Okay, I'm not going to try this. So I'm going to try to be really, really loud, but you know that is against who I am. I'm not very, very strong vocally. But so we're going to look at Joshua chapter 1, and we're going to talk about possessing our future, okay? So we can look at this in two ways. Do you have a vision for your life? Do you have a plan for your life? Do you have a plan? Is there something that's motivating you? There's vision that's moving you forward. Like, what about yourself? What is your plan? What is the plan for your life? What is the vision for your life? What about your family? What about your job, your career? What is your plan or your vision for the future? I've been asking that question about my life, my marriage, but also recently have been asking that same question about Coolidge Church of Nazarene. I've been asking the Lord, what is your vision? What is your continued vision as you build your church here? What is the vision that you have for CCN? Okay, so there's this plan that's out there, and we're going to look at this guy. His name is Joshua. So, again, if I were to ask you about your future, like your plans, your goals, your dreams, the first question I would ask you this morning is, would you be able to share those? I mean, would you be able to share about, yeah, this is my plans, this is kind of my dreams, this is kind of like what I see happening in my life. So we're going to talk about plans. I love Ephesians. If you got your, we can still show it on the screen. So, yes. Oh, good, thank you. I'll hopefully get this right. Ephesians 3, one of my favorite scriptures is found. Ephesians 3, 20 and 21. And I use the Amplified Version. It says, now to Him, by the way, Him is not me. Now to, everybody do this, put your hands up. Now to Him who is able to carry out His purposes and do super abundantly more than all that we dare ask or think, infinitely beyond our what? Greatest prayers, hopes, or dreams, according to what? His power that is at work where? Everybody do this. It's within us. But to Him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus. And I love this. Throughout all generations. Throughout all generations. This is not about you. This is not about me. This is about future generations. Amen. Think about it. This is all about that. It says throughout all generations forever and ever. So many people, by the way, I hope you don't do this. I hope you don't just accept what's handed to you. Some people just go through life and they just kind of accept what's handed to them without really focusing toward possessing the future that God has for them. So I'm going to talk about Joshua today. He was a good example for us to follow, and he knew how to possess the future. So Joshua was the man chosen by God, and remember, he was chosen by God to do what? Moses was finished. He was actually dead. And now it's Joshua, and he's moving the people into the promised land, okay? So Joshua's goal is to lead people into the promised land. They've wandered around, by the way. Have you ever felt like you're wandering? Most people that don't have a plan, they wander, right? Most people that don't have a plan, they just kind of wander. And these people, there was a plan. The plan was, hey, you're going to go across and you're going to take the land. But they said, no, we can't do this. There's too many people in that land, too big for us to go in. And because they didn't want to do the plan, guess what they did? They wandered around. Anybody feel like they're wandering? Wandering in this desert for 40 years because they wouldn't move into and possess the plan, the Jordan, to cross the Jordan. And God had told Joshua something along these lines, by the way. He's got this, I love the thoughts of this, but he's kind of like, Joshua, you got a tremendous future ahead of you. Okay, think about this God talking. I love that. Because God speaks to me and he's speaking to you today that God has a tremendous plan for you, right? He says, God doesn't say you're a nobody. You're nothing. He says something like, God says, I got a tremendous plan for you, Joshua. I'm going to do great things in your life. Anybody feel like that way? God is going to do great things in your life. Joshua, I'm going to do super abundantly more than all that you dare ask or think. I'm going to do it infinitely beyond your greatest prayers, hopes, or dreams according to my power that is worked within you. But there's a dynamic here. There's a dynamic here, Joshua. There's a dynamic at work here. I'll give you everything I promised and more. Don't you like that? I'll give you everything I promised and more. Can you say that with me? And more. It's not just what he promised. It's and more. But here's the dynamic. It's going to be a fight. I'm going to fulfill my promise. I'm going to do, Joshua, what I said I'm going to do. But you have to be willing to possess it. You have to be willing. I think God is saying something very similar to us today. I think it's individually, and I think it's corporately. I think he's saying something. I think he says, I've got great things I want to do in your life. Ooh. Make it personal. God wants to do great things in my life. Do you believe that? Because that is truly the beginning. God wants to do great things in your life. You've got a tremendous future ahead. Amen? You've got a tremendous future ahead. Infinitely. Infinitely beyond your greatest prayers, beyond your greatest hopes, things that you haven't ever even dreamed of. You can't even, God says you cannot even dream it big enough. And you know, some people, we're living there. We think we've kind of arrived. And God's saying, no, you have not arrived. You have not even seen what I can do with a fully surrendered life. You have no clue. You think you've arrived. You think you've come. He goes, I've got so much more for you, more than you ever dreamed. All, by the way, all your past is a prologue. All of your best days are ahead of you. Can you say that with me? All of my best days are ahead of me. Claim this. All of my best days are ahead of me. Amen? All of my best days are ahead of me. But it's going to be a battle. You must step and possess your future. Don't, by the way, don't settle. Some people are selling right now for good. When God says, I got the best, right? Think about that. I love Jeremiah 29:11. It says, "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for what? Disaster. To give you what? A future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your hearts." How do you possess this future? How do you possess this future? How do we do that? So in Joshua chapter 1, God gives Joshua this pep talk, okay? And I love it. God, God is just talking to Joshua. By the way, God's talking. I'm telling you, last night when I was out walking and praying over our city, I was so broken. I was praying for people. People were popping in my mind. God was talking everywhere. Every step I took in our community, God was there. He was talking. He was talking. So Joshua, God is giving Joshua this pep talk. He says, now, it's going to be a battle, okay? Oh, I know that. Anybody with me?
Okay.
It's going to be a battle. And for the next 20 years, and God says, so I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to encourage you ahead of time. If it's easy, everybody's going to do it. But the things that God's calling us to are not going to be easy, right? Personally and corporately as a church. But he says, I think if you do a few things, you just do these things, I'm going to bring success into your life. And that's all. God's saying, if you do these things, by the way, if God says you do these things, I'm going to bring this success in your life. If you follow this plan, I'm going to bring success in your life. So think about that. Really, it's really important. So this is it. God's strategy for success. I think the first thing is this, and you write this in, set up a plan. You got to have a plan, people. You got to have a plan. By the way, whether you are 10, 14, 40, 60, 80, or 92, you should have a plan. I'm sorry, you should have a plan. God wants to do something in your life. And you gotta put some things down on paper. You gotta set some God plans and you gotta set some God's goals. By the way, you might be saying, well, I don't even know how to set goals. If you write this down, it's called SMART goals, S-M-A-R-T. SMART goals. By the way, my coach has got me doing SMART goals now. Yeah, thank you, coach. Yeah. But SMART goals stands for specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and timely SMART goals. You can go on, Google it, and you'll find all the information. It'll help you to know how to set goals. Okay? So some of you may go, I don't know how to set goals. SMART goals. So you got to do some work, right? Because it's going to be 20 years of battle. So, by the way, I'm not talking about just any plan or any goals. I'm talking about a God plan, some God goals for your life. And the way we're going to discover that God plan, by the way, is where? Through prayer. Through abiding in Him. Through getting close to Him. So it's important for you to understand, praying and planning go together. Write it in. Praying and planning. By the way, most of us plan, but we never pray. Oh, we plan, but then do we ever pray about it? We get our 12 steps ready to go. We're planning, and God says, okay, so now where do I? Because if this plan is about something that I have for your life, shouldn't I have some way in here? Think about that. God's plan. So we pray, praying and planning, because why? God's way is better than our way. I mean, turn to someone and say, God's way is better than our way. Y'all, some of you don't think that today. You're going, I don't quite like God's way. But God's way is better than your way. God's way is planned. By the way, it's bigger than your plan. Amen? Y'all got some plans, but God's plan is bigger than your plan. Now, I hope like I'm not yelling and screaming. I'm actually really excited about just the word that God's just laying out here. I love Ephesians 2:8-10. It's not in the notes there. For by grace you've been saved through faith. Amen. Say, through faith.
Amen.
Amen. And this is not your own doing. It is what? A gift from God. Say, gift of God.
Gift of God.
Not as a result of works, so that no man may boast. But verse 10 is so important. Don't forget this. For we are His workmanship. We were created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared when? Before Him. Before the world was spoken into existence, before anything was happening, this is beforehand that we should walk in them. Truly, truly God's plans, His are superabundantly more than all that you dare ask or think, infinitely beyond your greatest prayers, hopes, or dream. First, what do you have to do for these plans? We have to stay open. We have to turn to someone and say, we've got to stay open. And we've got to let God have His way. Here it is. You got to stay open and you got to let God have His way. So now we got to that first verse of Joshua. He says, now that my servant Moses is dead. By the way, not a good way to start. But the truth is, Moses is dead. Turn to someone and say, Moses is dead. Moses has lived his life. And guess what? Remember the generations? It's going on. It's not over because Moses is dead, right? Some of you think that when you're dead, it's over. No, no. Generations. Quit thinking that you're dead and it's done. Think about generations. Think beyond you. You're going, well, maybe my kids are, I can't do anything. Well, don't think about your kids anymore. Find someone else that will want to do. I mean, just think about that. Think about that. Moses is dead. He said, you must leave, by the way, this is really, you must leave my people across the Jordan River into the land I'm giving to you. So have you ever thought, by the way, just this is free. You don't have to pay for this today. That all the people that are around you, that there's so many people that are living in a spiritual desert. They're everywhere. They're just wandering around. And they know in their heart and their mind, they know that there's more purpose in life, but they feel trapped. They feel trapped. But you and I, as a Christ-like disciple, we are called to lead people out of the spiritual desert. Amen. That's part of our purpose. How do I know that? Because Jesus said before He left, go and make disciples. He didn't tell us to just go sit on our butts. Go sit in church. He said, go and make disciples. That's powerful, isn't it? So everybody is a part of this. Like in there, Joshua was supposed to lead him across. But we have a challenge too, to lead people out of the spiritual desert to the abundance of God's love and His forgiveness and His grace and His mercy. So I would ask you a question. Do you have a plan? Do you have a plan to reach those people that are wandering around? Because really, that probably should be our biggest plan. Think about that. So here's Joshua's assignment. Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore, arise, go over the Jordan. This Jordan, arise, go over the Jordan. No questions, you're going over the Jordan. And by the way, Joshua's so excited because you know the story beforehand. Joshua and Caleb had 12 spies, they went into the land. 10 said, no, 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 they're too big. And Joshua and Caleb said, let's go. 40 years before this, they were ready then, and now they've had 40 years to even get more ready. So he is so excited. I can't, you know, he's like, can you see him? Can you see him? He's like a kid in a candy shop. I can't wait. So he says, rise, go over this Jordan, you and all the people, into the land that I'm giving to them, to the people of Israel. And I love this. God, everybody get your feet moving. Everybody get moving. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you. Oh. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you. God reminded me something last night as I was walking around our community, that this did not begin with me. As I was walking around, you know what? I was standing on the shoulders of great men and women of the churches of this community, that have walked this community and prayed over this community for the salvation of this community. Amen? Give the Lord a praise offering. And I was reminded that He said, every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you just as I promised to Moses. That is the same scripture that we prayed to the west here when we began 21 years ago. We prayed over this land. It was empty. It was barren. It was empty. It was barren. It was empty. And we began to pray over this land. But what's our plan now? What's our plan now? Think about this. This is assignment. This is what, and here's Joshua. By the way, here's Joshua's response. I love this, that he doesn't try to battle with God. He says, in verse 11, Joshua 1:11, here's Joshua's response. Are you ready for this? pass through the midst of the camp and command the people. Key word, prepare. Everybody, prepare. Say that word with me. Prepare your provisions. For within 3 days you are to pass over this Jordan to go into, take possession of the land that the Lord your God, what? Is giving you to what?
Possess.
He's not giving you a portion of the land, by the way, people. He's saying take possession of the land. All of it, okay? I like that. Don't you like that? I think that's so powerful. What a beautiful truth. That what God is calling us to do. Joshua has a plan. He's ready to act on God's promises. All God's giants have been weak men who did great things for God because they reckoned on His promise and His power and His presence within them and with them. I want you to fill this in for me, that the future belongs to the person who prepares for it. By the way, you got to have a journal. If you don't have a journal, you need to go get you one. I'm not going to shame you. Get you a journal. And every time you pray, and every time you open up your Bible, you should have that journal there. Why? Because He's going to give you something to write out. You need to be listening when you're praying and when you're reading, because you need a journal. And that's how you prepare for it. Prepare your provisions. What are your plans for your spiritual life? If you just got saved in your journey and you are just like that's all there is, there's more. You are not called to just get saved. Part of getting saved is the consecration of discipleship. You were called to get saved and then start living as a disciple. Right? Yes, we're saved by grace through faith, of course, but we've disconnected. We get saved, we come to church, and we sit, and we don't continue to grow. How are you growing? What's your plan? What's your year plan? Whether you're 12 or 100, what are our plans to grow spiritually? What about plans for your physical life, your finances? So we don't have all the details, but Joshua had been preparing all of his life, amen, under this great leader of Moses, for this leadership position God had placed him in. You guys, you are where God wants you to be at this very moment. Turn to someone and say, you are where God wants you to be at this very moment. You are where God wants you to be at this very moment. Every experience is a part of His divine plan. This wasn't, by the way, this wasn't something that was given to him like in the spur of a moment. Joshua had a plan for leadership. And you've got to have a plan, but not just a plan. Guess what kind of a plan you have to have? You've got to have a God plan. Psalms 37:5 says this: commit your way to the Lord, trust in Him, and He will act. And by the way, God is not part of the plan. He is a plan. I'm so thankful we have this, by the way. I want you to say, most people don't function this way. They give God a slice of the pie. We don't, and God normally goes down to church, by the way. That's where God's at. He's in church. He's not there. Normally, He's just a part of the pie. But that's not what the Scriptures say. The Scriptures say, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. God is at the center of everything. God is at the center of the church, politics, health, family, recreation, work, all else. God is at the center of it when you start planning. Don't forget that. See, so often we've been taught that we've been sectioning, and we've been giving God a section of our life. That's not how it works biblically. He says that we're to be what? A few weeks ago, living sacrifices, right? We are to give our lives to Him. Think about that. D.L. Moody says this: every great movement of God can be traced to a kneeling figure, because praying and planning go together. Oswald Chambers says this: prayer does not finish for the greater work. Prayer is the greater work. Elizabeth Elliot says this: prayer lays hold of God's plan and becomes the link between His will, everybody with me, point out, His will, His kingdom come, His will be done where? On earth as it is in heaven. His will, and it's accomplished on earth. Amazing thing happens when we are given the privilege of being the channels of the Holy Spirit's prayer. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, trust the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understandings. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He's going to what? He's going to make your path straight. So the point is that successful people pray and plan for the future. Are we doing that? Are we doing that? Are we praying? And are we making plans, God plans, for the future? Or are we drifting? Are we drifting through life? You got to have a plan, people. The second thing for this morning is very crucial. It's got to stay in the Word. God said to Joshua, you're going to be in a battle, and for the next 20 or 25 years, you're going to be fighting. And the Bible is your instruction manual for conflict.
Amen.
Anybody want to know what they can do with their marriage if they're having struggles? All right. Look into the Bible. If you're having trouble with a relationship, look into the Bible. You trying to figure out God's will for your life? Look in the Bible. You struggling with an addiction? Look in the Bible. Think about this. Look at the Bible. It's the manual for the battles of life. Joshua 1, 6, and 7 says this. Note this. Be strong and courageous, for you shall cause this people to inherit the land. I love it. Be strong and courageous. For you shall cause this people to inherit the land that I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous now, being careful to do what? According to all that the law that Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may have good success wherever you go. And this is the challenge here. Don't turn away from the law I've written. Don't turn away from God's word. Don't get what? Sidetracked. All right? So whatever it is, thank you, Jesus, for the big sound this morning. That sound that just blew up. Because it reminded me that that's what the enemy does. He does bombs here and there, and he blows them up. They're big and they're small, and he's trying to get you distracted, and that's what he wants to do. He wants to get you sidetracked. You know, we get so excited about our relationship with Jesus. I don't know about you. I remember when I got saved, and I was so excited. And man, I was hungry and thirsty for the word and prayer and sharing my faith with people. But somewhere along the line, church got to me. Yeah. I got sidetracked. I got distracted. It's so easy to get sidetracked when things like your career. Things become more, not that they're not important, but they can become more important than God. We can get sidetracked by sports today. Sports aren't big. But we get sidetracked all the time. We get sidetracked by hobbies, financial success, financial difficulties, illnesses, children, or whatever. And somehow in the process, we can lose our focus on what the Word of God says. One of the greatest promises in the Bible is found in verse 8. It says, study this book of instructions continually. Meditate on it day and night so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then, by the way, circle that if you've got your Bibles, only then will you prosper and succeed. That word succeed is so important in all you do. Verses 7 and 8, success is promised twice. In verse 7 it says, don't turn away from the law. Stay with the Bible and you will be successful. Stay with the Bible and you will be successful. Verse 7. And then he says, keep your mind saturated with the Word of God and you'll be successful. You need to fill this in. God's promise of success has absolutely nothing to do with your ability. God's promise of success in your life has everything to do with your commitment to His Word. It's not about my ability, it's about my availability. Think about that for a second. He says, what? Study. And we have so many Bible translations we can study. I mean, we can study with people on YouTube, we can study online. Study. We can hear the Word, we can read the Word, we can study it. There's so many. But then he says, think, meditate on the Word of God. Think about how important that is in verse 8. Meditate on it day and night. Think about the Bible. whenever you get into situations and you're struggling, think about what the Bible, what would the Bible say at this point? What would God's word tell me to do at this point? And then he says, live it. Live it. Don't just study, just don't think about it, but live it. That's where it comes in. You gotta obey what the word of God says. See, God says this. He says, you obey the premise, and I'll fulfill the promise. And there is this almost like this blank check that says you will succeed. If you obey God's word and you meditate and you think about it and you obey it, you're going to succeed. So study the word, think about the word, and live the word. And then what are we going to do? Sit back and what? Watch. The only time we can sit back is watch God bless us. We get to sit back and watch God bless us because we've studied His word, we've thought about it, we've lived. 2 Timothy 3:16-17 says this. All scripture, by the way, is inspired by God. Amen?
Yes.
Progressive Christianity. Other quote, religions that are taking the scriptures apart and adding their own scriptures, stay away. Stay away. Stay away. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It straightens us out and teaches us to do what is right. It is God's way of preparing us in every way, fully equipped for every good thing God wants us to do. So this scripture tells me something about reading God's word. God's word straightens me out. Anybody need straightened out? I'm telling you. I'm a mess sometimes, but God straightens me out through His Word. He helps me to know how to walk on the path and how to walk rightly. God's Word, it warns me when I get... Anybody ever got off the path? Anybody? Come on. Anybody ever got off the path? Okay, come on. We've all... And some of you need to go back to the altar and pray. But God's Word will help you to get back on the path. It says, Your Word is a lamp to guide my feet and a light for my path. I promise it once and I'll promise it again. I will obey Your righteous regulations. Psalms 119:10 says this, I have tried hard to find You. Don't let me wander from where? Your commands. Don't let me go to the left or right. Don't let me wander from Your Word, God. I have hidden Your word where in my heart that I what? Might not sin against You. That's what happens. I praise You, O Lord. Teach me Your decrees. I love one last scripture. It's found in Psalms 19. It says, reverence for the Lord is pure. It's lasting forever. The laws of the Lord. The word of God is true. Each one is fair. They are more desirable than gold. Even the finest gold. They are sweeter than honey. Amen. I love this. The things in the world are not honey, people. They are bitter. They are bitter. God's word says it's sweeter than honey, even honey dripping from the comb. They are warming to your servant, a great reward for those who obey Him. So I know, by the way, Joshua, he's got a whole nation of people. He's going over to Jordan. Do you think Joshua's busy? Right? I think I just have trouble with like maybe 70 or 80 people trying to lead them across the Jordan, right? But he was probably pretty busy, right? Y'all smiling at me, right? Right? You know, and I have to work on that, by the way, because I realized something just recently, that it's not my plan, it's God's plan.
Amen.
That He's unfolding. And by the way, I'm crossing the Jordan. And I hope you go with me, CCN, because we're crossing. Because there's a community out there that needs Jesus. And we're going to cross. We are going to cross. I love this. Joshua, he was a busy man. He had an entire nation. He didn't have a lot of extra time on his hands, by the way. No extra time. But he made time to abide.
Yes, Lord.
He made time to abide. He made time for God's word. He made time for prayer. He made time, quiet time, to listen to God. You've got to plan that. Because if you don't, your kids are going to rob you of that. Your job is going to rob you of that. The distractions that are going to rob you. You've got to plan those things. If you don't plan them, you won't have it. By the way, I wrote this down, and this is going to hurt. Y'all ready? Y'all ready? Yeah, my daughter's already going like this. If you've got time for social media and no time for God, you are distracted.
That's right.
Don't tell me the next time that you're watching Netflix and you're on your phone and you spend 10 minutes in your Bible, that's, I'm sorry, am I, is it? I mean, a year ago November, I got rid of my Facebook because of that very thing. I was doing it for a good thing. I thought that Facebook was a good thing for me. By the way, it's not nothing wrong with Facebook, okay? But I had to get rid of Facebook, and I've had to get rid of several other things on my social media because it was distracting me. There's some of you, you know what I'm talking about. You're on social media, you're watching things that are impure. It's distracting you. You're hearing things that are not correct. It's distracting you. Sometimes the best thing you can do is have a plan, and guess what? Get rid of it. Don't let these things tie themselves around and drag you down. Okay, we need to pray, and we need to set a plan. We need to stay in the Word, and then this is the last thing. If you want to go, yeah, you both want to play. You got to step out in faith.
That's right.
Step out in faith. That's where we're at. As a matter of fact, for the next 4 weeks, we're going to be doing the book of Haggai. If you want to get a head start on chapter 1 next week. And every Sunday night for 4 weeks, at 5 o'clock, we're going to do Bible study, short, 1 hour, 15 minutes. But we're going to talk as the church. And you're the church, and I hope you can be there. Because we're going to talk about what it means to be the church in our day, and what God's calling us to do. But we got to step out, amen? We got to step out. And I like that word, step out. Why? Because stepping out is an action, amen? It's not about thinking about it, right? It's not about just something that's in your head. Faith means to commit yourself to do what you believe in. The God plans, the God goals. You must step out in faith because faith is an action. And notice the three times what God says to Joshua. He says, be strong and courageous in verses 6, 7, and 9. Why did God say to Joshua, be strong and courageous? Because God knew that there were a lot of things that Joshua was going to face. Be strong and courageous, Nikki, because you're going to get distracted. Joyce, be strong and courageous because you might get discouraged. You might even be depressed. These are all things that Joshua is going to possibly... I mean, you can't take a nation that is just wandering. He said, be strong and courageous because God will be with you. Just as God was with them, God will be with you. He will be with us every step of the way. Now it's up to Joshua to just step out in faith. Now it's time for us as a church to step out in faith. We've had several years, and we've kept as best we can in tune with the Lord. But I'm going to say it's not several years. I'm going to say it's 4 to 5 years that we've just been waiting and kind of sitting back. And I believe God is saying it's time to step out. It's time for us as a people, as a church, to truly, truly hear from God and follow through with the plans. Now think about this. Some background in closing. The children of Israel had been wandering around in the desert for 40 years. And now they're standing on the Jordan River, and they're ready to cross over into this new land. And guess what? The moment that they step across in this new land, it's an act of aggression. Y'all don't see this. It's an act of aggression. When they step across, it's an act of aggression. Let me tell you, every time you take a step of faith, it's an act of aggression. There is literally a 7 nations that are stronger and more prepared. And when they step across and they hit that mountain, it is an act of war. They will be throwing down the gauntlet the moment they get to the other side. Every time you make a step of faith, the enemy knows it. And let me tell you, if you're just going to stand back, the enemy is happy to let you do that. Because you're not a threat to him. But the moment you step out, it's an act of aggression. and there is a war going on. On the other side of the river, there were seven nations, every one of them larger and stronger than the Israelite nation. Israel didn't have any army. They'd been in slavery for 400 years. They're going to cross the river, enter into who knows how long a period of battle and war. And now, when you read the scriptures, you understand why God says to Joshua, what? Be strong and courageous. Why? Because I've called you to do this. I'm going before you. He said in verse 9, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened. By the way, enemy number one, frightened. And do not be dismayed. Enemy number two is discouragement. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Hey, Joshua, you can have confidence in moving ahead because you've got to remember who you're doing this for, who we're doing this for. We're doing this for the King of Kings. We're on assignment from the Almighty God. Amen? Are you excited about it? We are on an assignment from the Almighty God. Amen? Anybody with me here? Anybody? Yeah. We are on assignment from the Almighty. He is the King of Kings. All we need to do is do everything He tells us to do. To do what He tells us to do. To do it His way, to step out in faith, to not be afraid and not be discouraged. By the way, it will come. But remember, you do not be strong and courageous for the Lord. See, the bottom line is this. God says, don't be afraid, don't be discouraged, I'm with you. Amen? He didn't say you're not going to be afraid and you're not going to be discouraged. He says, don't fear those things because they're going to come. We've all been discouraged. We've all been, right? We all have it. But he says, don't. Don't buy into them. Don't buy the lie. Fill this in closing. It's fear and discouragement that keeps us in the desert when we should be living in the promised land. So step out. Set a plan. Stay in God's word and step out. Set a plan, not just any plan, God's plan. Prayer and planning go together. Stay in God's word. Don't go to the left or right. Get you a journal because some things are going to be happening in your life. Whether it's individually or corporately, there's some things that are going to be happening in your life. Get you a journal. Be ready to write those things down. And then when He speaks, step out. Because I would rather face discouragement and fear in the promised land than to stay in that land and never be challenged in my faith, right? This is where God's calling you. This is where God's calling us as people. Do you sense? Have you not sensed this? Is anybody with me? Are you sensing this in your spirit? That this whole thing in the last couple of years or even before then, that this has just been a preparation almost. That God has almost had to, I think God has had to strip the churches. And He's had to get rid of all those things in the churches that have been holding them back. And it truly, truly, if churches, and I'll say this, I'm okay, here we go. If churches are really listening right now, they won't be picking up the things that they used to do. There'll be some new things that God is already doing that He wants to do in the future. And I'm assured that God has been pruning CCN back for a purpose. And I've been praying, God, begin with me. Begin in my life. Work for me. We've got to set a plan. Please be a part of it. Be praying for the church. Take time to come and be a part of our plan. Read. I believe everyone has value. I believe God's speaking. Set a plan. Read your Bibles. Study your Bible. And step out. Amen. Now, I love the fact. You can go ahead. Just for you, but for the sins of the world. So if you ever think that that was just a vent and disconnect from it, you're missing the whole point. That blood that was shed back then was shed for you. Because without the shedding of the blood, you cannot have forgiveness of the sin. There is no forgiveness of sins without the shedding of the blood. This is what makes possible. His blood makes possible our forgiveness in 2022. And all those people that God wants to reach in 2022, His blood, without the shedding of the blood, there can be no forgiveness. So your forgiveness, my forgiveness, was blocked by Jesus' blood. May we never ever come to communion again and take it and not remember the truth of what happened. That Jesus loved us. That He was beaten. His blood was shed so that we could have forgiveness of sin today. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ shed for you. Preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ died for you.
Thank you. Amen.